Guys, you may get arise with so many doubts. So I would not ask you to ask the doubts today. I want you to practice it and then come up with the doubts tomorrow. If there are some small doubts, I can take it at the end of the session. Okay. So we are gonna understand what loops are, how to use the conditions, what is for loop, while loop, and etc. Right. So before that, let us understand how to play with list. Okay, because yesterday I told you, list is something very important. You know, you should know how to access list. Right. So there are some steps. Understand the concept of indices. I have made you understand the concept of indices. Working with empty list, I will make sure you do it. Like if there is a list which is empty, how to use it, I'll let you know. Adding and popping values in the list. Okay. How to add and how to pop the values in the list. Understand the length concept. Okay. How to know the length of any list. Okay. And how to set the list. Now, what is setting? For example, you have a list. Wait a second. For example, you have a list. Now here you can see there are some values which are getting repeated, 1 and 2 and 3, right? So there are some times when you don't need these repeated values. At that instance, at that moment, what you do, you set the list so that all the repeated values get deleted, okay, with their indices. So that is why we use set in the list. Am I clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so let's move ahead. Now, what are algorithms, right? For instance, I want to loop something. I want to loop how to subtract two numbers. So I have a strategy, right? I will take two numbers and then I will put them into a variable or not put them into a variable, depends on to the requirements. I'll take two numbers and then I'll subtract them and then I'll print them. This is what a sequence, you know, this is what a strategy, it pops into my mind, right? For instance, if I want to build a house, so what is the strategy? I'll grab all the materials, then, you know, I'll make the concrete, I'll have the bricks, I'll make the walls and the windows and whatsoever. So I'll have a strategy, I have a strategy of everything, right? So that are what algorithms are. Before making any, like, what shall I say, code, before writing any syntax, I prefer students to write algorithms, right? Because the way you make strategies in your mind, the way it gets easier for you to make the code, right? For example, if I say, I want to make a T. I mean, that's a simple thing. I want to make a T. So how will I make a T? Anyone? That I want to be done in 5 steps. What could be the first step? Anyone?
Get all the materials.
Exactly. Now the second step?
Light up the gas or...
Exactly. Yeah, exactly. You can burn the, you can keep the vessel and put all, you can keep the vessel, right?
Yes, ma'am.
You can put all the ingredients. Then what you can do? You can burn the gas. And then boil it till it gets ready. I mean, this is the basic algorithm of making a tea. Right. So that's now fine. I know this strategy. I don't think so. Someone put the ingredient first and then get all the materials. No, you first get it and you put the ingredients, right? You have a strategy and it is a sequential strategy, right? So before coding, I prefer everybody, I want everyone to write algorithms, okay? Try and write algorithms and then go to code. Now next, we'll try to, this is a basic algorithm of adding two numbers. I initialize two numbers with a variable, right? X is equals to 12 and Y is equals to 13. We did it yesterday. So what I did, I initialized two variables with a number, like two different numbers, okay? Using the arithmetic operator, I added two numbers, right? I used arithmetic operators and then I printed the number. So this was the basic strategy to make or to add two numbers, right? So are you clear how algorithm works and how you have to use algorithm to make a code, like before making a code? Am I clear?
Yes. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Next. Now we'll give introduction to loops and conditions, right? Now, loops and conditions. Why we use loops and conditions? For instance, I want to multiply seven numbers I have in a list. I have seven numbers in a list and I have to multiply it, right? I can't do it. Like, I cannot do it without, per se, I cannot use this algorithm, this arithmetic operator, without using a loop. Or I just can't take two numbers in the NAR and taking the third number from the third index and then adding. I mean, it's all complicated, okay? To make it easy, to make it more practical, we use loops. And we apply some conditions to it. So that is what we are gonna know. That is what we're gonna learn. And make sure that you understand for loop, while loop, and whatsoever gonna come in future. So that you can at least build a small loop today, right? A small code using loop today. A small code using if and else statement today, right? So what is the purpose of loop? Why I use loop? For instance, I am building a big code. I'm making a product. Okay, I'm making a big product. I have to like 1500 or 2000 line of code. Okay, so for instance, there is some code which is getting repeated. For instance, I have written a code to upload any image, right? And I have to use it after every instance. So I cannot write that 15 line of code again and again. So that is not efficient, right? So what I do, I make a code, I make a loop, okay? And I iterate it for the number of times, right? That makes it easy, right? That makes it reliable. So that is the purpose of using loops, okay? Then why we apply loops? We apply loop to meet some conditions, okay? We have some conditions, we have some questions, and to solve that condition, we apply loops. So there are several types of loops and everything is used according to their demands, according to their requirements, right? So this is a daily life example which I have given you. Okay, for loop. So for instance, you're making a wall, you're building a wall, okay? And you have 100, bricks, okay? Now you have to make a wall. What do you do? You'll take one brick, then you'll put it. Then you'll take the second brick, you'll put it onto the first brick. Then you'll take the third and so on. You'll do it till the 100 brick, right? That's what the looping is. How much will you go to make a wall? Till the 100th brick, right? And after reaching the 100th brick, you will stop, right? Why did you stop? Because your condition got end. You have nothing left, right? What was your condition to make a wall with 100 bricks? You're done with it. Now you will stop. Am I clear?
Yes, ma'am.
This is how your loop works. You go until it is required, and the moment your condition gets satisfied, you stop. Am I clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now we'll go to Python for loop. Okay. Now, in the loop, you can iterate the loop number of times, like 100 breaks, 100 times, 2000 times. It depends upon your requirement, right? In C, C++, we use for loop in some different manner. We write for, and then we have these small brackets, and we have these three conditions, start, end, and iteration, right? We have these three conditions, and then we start it. Okay, but in Python, we use in, okay, to initialize any loop. For I in range, or for I in value, something like that. Okay. For I in range, after writing this, you have this square, like small brackets. Okay. And in the small bracket, you can write the range, you can write the, the list, or you can write whatsoever it is required at that position, right? Now, this is the simple example. Now let's see if I write it, what will it print, okay? Okay, this is Google Colab. Okay, the one which I'm using right now is Google Colab. Okay, this is something which is which has been it's a cloud. Okay, I'm coding it in a cloud. Okay, now you can use Google Colab. You just have to go to your Google. You have to write Google Colab. You have to go to it. It's just like your your editor or your it is moreover like a Jupyter. I mean, have you ever worked? I mean, today we'll work with Jupyter. Okay, I'll show you how to work with Jupyter. And I'll also show you how to work with Sublime Text. Okay, so you can press on this new notebook, or you can upload from a Google Drive or from a GitHub, or you can also upload it from your local computer. After doing this, you will get your your Google Colab. Now you just have to write the code, right? So let's do it once. I mean, are you all with the internet and your laptop right now?
Yes, ma'am.
Right, so let's go to Google Colab, okay, and let's code a line or a syntax so that you understand how to work with Google Colab, because there are industries who has a great requirement of Google Colab, right? So after like writing or after whatever you're coding, you can download it in IPYNB and also in .py version. So I have already told you .py we use for Sublime, right? Writing on at Sublime, we use .py. But when we code in Jupyter, we use .ipynb. Am I clear?
Yes, ma'am.
So everyone, go to your internet, write Google Colab. I have just told you the steps. Do it, and then we'll write something. Just a syntax. And when you're done, just write on the chat or just unmute yourself and let me know that, okay, you are on your Google Colab editor.
Yes, ma'am, I've opened the Google Colab editor.
Everyone, this I want to hear
from
everyone. It's done? Cool.
Yeah, it's open. Yeah, it's done.
Right. Let's print hello.
Ma'am.
Yeah.
Next question. Yeah, I have a question.
Yeah, sure.
Like we can use either of it, right? Either Colab or
you can use anything.
Yeah.
See, Jupyter works on a local host. Okay. It works on a local host. And this works on your cloud system. So that is the only difference. So it depends upon the requirements and also upon your choice. If you want to code, if you don't want to waste your memory, so you just can open Google Colab and you just can code. Or if you're okay with using your local host, you can do that. Am I clear?
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
Welcome. So just, you can write print. Let's print your name, everyone. Okay. And after writing this, you just have to press Control Enter. Any problem to anyone?
No, ma'am.
Great. This is text. Okay, you can write text. So whatever you can write, like you write comments, right? So you can use it as writing comments, or you can use it as specifying something, right? You can write text, whatsoever text you want to write, okay? You can make it bold, you can make it index, you can also insert images, you can also insert some links, okay? So it's really crazy, it's really cool. So Abhi, now I hope you can like code in Google Colab, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Crazy. Everyone having Jupyter notebook right now?
I'm having it.
Anyone of you who does not have Jupyter notebook? Crazy. Now we'll open Jupyter notebook. Everybody go to your Jupyter notebook. Okay. So I have this here. So we'll see. We'll check how to work with Jupyter notebook as well. I'm telling you this today. I did not tell you yesterday. There was a reason, because today you're going to use loops and all, and I want you to do it practically. And yesterday it was just a basic class. So everyone should be familiar with how to work with three of them. I'll also tell you Sublime. So press yes, like, and you will have your Jupyter sometime. So it's like, it's kind of, I mean, it's like kind of slow. I mean, you have seen that, right? The moment you typed Google Colab, it was onto your screen in some minute or some seconds or whatsoever. See, it's using your local host. 8888. My local host is 8888. You might have something else or similar. It depends. So here you can go, everybody. Are you done till here?
Yes, ma'am.
Crazy. Okay. So you can upload again. You can upload from your, what shall I say, from your local system. Or you can go here as well. You can go from here. Or you can press new. Python 3 text file, you want folder, or you want terminal. It depends on your requirement. So right now I want Python 3, right? So this is your Jupyter. Okay. Here you can again go to new notebooks. You can open something. You can make a copy. You can save it. Okay. You can insert cells above and below. You can restart the kernels and whatsoever, right? So again, let's do that. Let's add three numbers. So I have after writing the score, you again have to press Control Enter. So this is how Jupyter notebook works. Have you all coded this? I mean, I'm deleting it. You don't have to see this. You have to code it by yourself. Take any three numbers and sum them up and use variables. If you have any doubt, let me know. Are you all done?
Yes,
Jupyter notebook, how can we get?
Pardon?
If we don't have this notebook, how can we get?
You don't have the Jupyter notebook right now?
No.
You installed Anaconda yesterday, did you?
Just installed this one, Python executable.
You're not audible.
Is it audible now?
Yeah.
I just installed Python executable file.
Okay, you just installed Python. So you have Google Colab, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
So Jupyter works exactly like Google Colab. So install it today. I'll tell you how to install it. Okay. Install it today. In the end of the session, I'll let you know. Install it today and then work with Jupyter. I mean, they are similar. It is similar. Google Colab and Jupyter works similar. The only difference is it works on the cloud. It works on the local host.
Okay.
Yeah. Just make sure that you know all of it. You just see to it how it works, right? So you can practice it today. And then if you have any query or doubt, you can talk to me or you can just ask me tomorrow, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So there is this Markdown. So we had text in Google Colab. We have Markdown in Jupyter Notebooks. So we just have to write something and then control enter. And this is how it works, right? We can also give headings to your thing, like whatsoever. So you can give headings, right? So this is how it works. Am I clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Crazy. Okay. So let's move ahead. Do you want me to show it with Sublime Text as well?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now, how to work with Sublime Text? Again, you have this Sublime Text. I want you all to do it, right? So, write anything. Okay, let's print something. Now, after printing, you can, okay, if you want to open any folder, okay, you can go to open folder. You can click whatsoever folder you want. The folder which carries all of your the required data or whatsoever, you just have to go to it and you just have to click on open, right? After opening it, you can do whatsoever you want. Okay, now I have saved this sum.py. I told you it. If you want to, like, if you have to save the file in Sublime Text using .py extension, right? Now you have to go to your terminal. After writing your code, you have to go to the terminal. Now you have to see where your file is, where your .py file is. It's somewhere in desktop. Then transtutor, then assignment 4, right? So I have to open it. To go to any folder, you have to write CD and the desktop. Make sure it's case sensitive. So if your desktop starts with capital D, you have to write capital D. If it starts with like small d, you have to write small d, right? If you write transtutor like this, it won't work, okay? Because it's case sensitive. Also, after writing, you can press tab. After writing a half of it, you can press tab. So it will automatically give your name, okay? If I don't want to go to assignment 4, I came here mistakenly, or I want to go to somewhere else, so I have to write CD dot dot. So you will come out of it. Am I clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Now again, go to assignment 4. Oh, sorry. And to access sum.py file, you have to write python 3 sum.py and then just enter. So it will work. Am I clear how to work with Sublime Text? Cool. So I generally work with Sublime Text, okay? Because when you start making products, when you start working on higher scales, generally people work on Sublime Text. They found it more better. I mean, obviously you cannot code the whole Flask when APIs and REST APIs using Jupyter or Google Colab per se. cannot make all the products. So generally people work with Sublime Text. So I mean, you are just starting with data analysis. I would prefer you to start with Jupyter or Google Colab as per your like availability and your mood. And then slowly and steadily, if you want, you can shift to Sublime Text. Okay. It does not look like it does not look catchy. I mean, obviously Sublime Text does not look catchy, but it's really very useful for coding. Okay, I was showing you something. You can now just we'll just copy it. You got something. You got 2, 4, 6, 8. You created a list. So if you want to create a list, what you can do, you can give the start point. Okay. You can give the end point, and also you can give the number of iterations. I asked my loop to go till 12, start from 2 and give a gap of 2, like 2, 4, 6, 8, 10. Am I clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Why it did not go to 12?
Because it ends one index before the last number.
Exactly, because the index starts from 0, not 1. No. That is the reason it ended at 10. But if I want to end it at 12, I'll write 40 and I can work. Right. If I want to give 3, this is how it works. So 11 plus 3 is 15, which is going out of range, right? So that is the reason it's stopped at 11. Now this is how you can create list. Am I clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Okay. So there is this code. Now I'll make you understand what this code is. I initialize the list. Okay, I had a list or I initialized a list, whatsoever you want to say. Now, I initialized a variable with 0, which is I have to store my output in something, right? After getting an output, store it somewhere, right? So I had a variable which I started with 0, okay? Now, I made a loop. Now, let's do it. Okay, I have a list. Any list? Right? Now, my aim is, what is my aim? I have to square all the values, like 1 square 1 is 1, 2 square 2 is 4, 3 square 3 is 9. I have to square all the values present in the list. This is my aim, right? Since there are like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 values, so I need to store it somewhere so that it gets stored somewhere and then I can print it, right? I just can't print it before storing it somewhere. So to store it, I started with, I had initialized a variable with 0. Now why I did 0, we'll see. Now, what is the range? Look here. Have I given any range here? No, I have given no range. I have just put list one because the moment it will start iterating, it iterates on all the list. I mean, all the values in the list. So it will iterate on all the indices in the list. That's how it will work, right? So what I have to write? Any doubt?
No, ma'am.
Crazy. Okay, now what I have to do? I have to square, right? All the values on every indices. So for I in list one means for 2, in list one, for three in list one, for four in list one, for five in list one, and for six in list one. So what I have to do? 2 into 2. That's what square is, right? So what exactly I have to do? I into Y, right? For this object, then for this, and for this. And then I have to store it in square. So what will I write? See, you got it. 4, 9, something, something. Okay, let me initialize it by 1. Let's see what happens. There is no change. Let me initialize it by 5. There is again no change. Why there is no change? Anyone? See, you can initialize the variable with anything you want in this case. Okay, in this case. It will not work in every cases. Right? You can do it here, because you're storing something in square after looping. Right? So it does not matter from where did you initialize your variable. So variable is independent in this case. Okay, there are cases where variable would be dependent. So in that, you cannot initialize according to your wish. But here, your variable is independent. I mean, whatsoever you initialize your square, it will not matter. If you don't write anything here, you will obviously get an error. So you have to initialize it by something. So you wrote 0. You can write anything. Am I clear?
Ma'am, yes, ma'am. I have a doubt.
Yeah, sure.
Over here, you're initializing with 0. You gave an example where you initialized square with 5.
Yeah.
Right. So in that case also, there was no change. Right. Yeah. But after the loop starts, the square value is equal to I times I. Yeah. Acha, sorry, ma'am. Got it.
It's okay. So let's move forward. Okay. It's okay. It's fine. So this is what all, you know, the looping works. Okay. Now this is what, please, I again ask you all to write an algorithm and then code. Okay. So I have written an algorithm and then I have coded it. Okay. Now this is where I introduced range. Okay. Here what I'm doing, I'm adding 5 natural numbers, which is like 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. So its sum is 15, right? And initialized it by 0. Okay, now what I'm doing? Now here, let's see what happens, okay? I supposedly have this code somewhere. See, you initialized by sum is equal to 0. You're using it like for value in range. I wrote I. You can write anything as per your wish. Okay. For value in range, for I in range, whatsoever. 1, 6. This is the range. Like from, you have to start it from 1 and you have to go to till 6. I mean, these are the indices. I told you 1, 6, and then the iterations, starting, ending, and then the iterations. Am I clear? So I'm calculating the sum. The sum is equals to sum plus value, and then I'm printing the sum. Okay, this is how it's working. Now, the sum is 10. Since it's 1, 5, so the sum is 10. It's not 15. Now, if I write here 1, and if I run it, see the sum is 11. Why it's 11? You can carry on.
Because you have initialized it to 1, so sum is equal to sum plus I. It'll be like 1 plus the value of I.
Exactly. So here your variable is dependent. In the first case, your variable was independent. So you could initialize with anything.
I want to stop here. It's going to session end here. So we'll take a break or we'll continue. I'm just expecting others. What you know we'll do? We'll take a 5-minute break or we'll start now?
So we can continue. I don't have any issues.
We'll continue, sir.
Okay, fine. I'll send another link quickly. Or Prachi, you need a break?
No, I'm fine.
Okay, fine. It's going to end now.